Now for our main event, the judge is in the house. We want to welcome Bradley Kauscher, partner, and Michael Besson Friedrich to introduce our speaker.
Thank you, President Karen. Derek Mosley graduated from Marquette University Law School in 1995, Northern Illinois. Derek, 92. Northern Iowa, excuse me, 92. Esteemed class of Marquette Law School, 1995. Classmates. After graduation, Derek served as assistant district attorney in Milwaukee County from 1995 to 2002. As assistant district attorney, he represented the state of Wisconsin over 1,000 criminal prosecutions.
Brad, I only have a couple of minutes.
I got 2 minutes. 2 minutes, exactly. Cutting to the chase, Derek served as chief municipal court judge after being appointed the youngest African-American to be appointed a judge in the state of Wisconsin. He thankfully ran unopposed in all those times, making his treasurer's job excruciatingly easy over those years. Recently retired from the bench in 2023, Derek became the director of the Lubar Center for Public Policy Research and Civic Education at our alma mater, Marquette University Law School, taking over for the position Mike Goucher had for those many years. A long list of accolades for Derek in the city of Milwaukee, but he married up. He married a Wisconsin girl, which made him stay here. Kelly's from Superior. But one of the passions that Derek has relates to organ donation as an organ donation recipient. And you might have seen him at Rose Bowl parades and other things. So keep an eye out for any organ donation piece. And I always encourage folks to make sure on your healthcare opportunity, check that box for organ donation. Derek got a live donor, but it's always an important thing to do. So without further ado, Derek Mosley.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Can everybody hear me?
Perfect. Perfect.
Louder?
I should have known. All right. Let me just pull up something real quick. Perfect. So before I really get started, I just want to talk real briefly about the Lubar Center. And so at the Lubar Center, we're actually a venue inside the law school. That's number one. But number two, we are a place where we try to bring in people from various different issues and various sides of those issues. And we want to bring them inside the Lubar Center to engage in intelligent civil discourse. And that's one of our rules. You can come in, you can disagree, but we just want to make sure that everybody's heard and everybody has an opportunity to speak. So if any of you are on LinkedIn, please feel free now or after we're over today to just give a follow to the Marquette University Law School Lubar Center. And you can get to see all the things that we have planned coming up this year. We have some really great activities coming up that you might want to partake in. So let me get started. So I entitled this lecture Blacks in History, and I rarely ever use Black history because I found when you use just Black history, some people tend to shut it out, saying it doesn't apply to me. So I use Blacks in History because a lot of things I'm going to talk about aren't just exclusively Black history, it's U.S. history. I see Chris Hendricks. Chris, how are you? It's good to see you. Chris was our chief court administrator at the municipal court for a long time. I missed you, Chris. Good to see you. All right. So I start this lecture with this picture, and I love this picture because this is the very last picture ever taken of Harriet Tubman. And I love this picture because she's just sitting there so regally, like on her throne. And Harriet Tubman was a woman who was born enslaved, escaped, made her way all the way to Pennsylvania, and then returned 13 more times to slave states to free other enslaved. And I love this picture because it just shows her in all her regal glory. I have her here as well, and I have her pictured with three individuals on the right. So you have there on the top, you have the second president of the United States, John Adams. In the middle, you have Thomas Jefferson, the third president of the United States. And then you have Ronald Reagan, the 40th president of the United States. And the reason why I have this picture together with Harriet Tubman is because when John Adams and Thomas Jefferson died, Harriet Tubman was alive. When Harriet Tubman died, Ronald Reagan was alive. So the president of the United States throughout the entire 1980s, the 40th president of the United States, was alive at the same time as the woman who was enslaved, left slavery, came back 13 times to save you. The reason why I use this slide is because to let you know that our history is far from ancient. Far from ancient. We're not that far removed from our history. Everybody probably seen the picture on the left. The left is of Ruby Bridges. Ruby Bridges was the young six-year-old girl who integrated the schools in New Orleans, Louisiana in 1960. You're probably familiar with her walking down the stairs with the Marshalls. In fact, Norman Rockwell did a painting of her walking with the Marshalls. On the right-hand side is a picture of Ruby Bridges today. Ruby Bridges is alive, and Ruby Bridges is just 68 years old. So think about that. Think about that. The little girl who integrated the schools in New Orleans, Louisiana, is only 68 years old. Our history is not that far. Not that far. I have these three girls up here because I think it's important that you know their story. You have Gail Etienne. You have Tessie Prevost, and you have Leona Tate. They're up there. And what's so interesting about these three girls is that I showed you the picture of Ruby Bridges, and you saw Ruby, and you know her story. But on that date, there were actually four total girls. They were called the New Orleans Four. It was Ruby, Gail, Tessie, and Leona. And for some reason, we've forgotten about these three young girls. And I'll tell you their story. They also went to school on the same day as Ruby. They also had to be escorted by U.S. Marshals into the school. They also actually had to run this gauntlet into the school where there were parents yelling and screaming. You might have seen the picture of the lady. She had a black Barbie doll or black baby doll, and she had a noose around its neck as she walked in. These three girls walked into school. They got to school, and prior to the day starting, the principal had received a phone call that said if you allowed these girls into the school, that we were going to take our kids out of school. So on the first day of school, these three girls show up at McDonough Elementary in New Orleans. They show up, they walk in, and the principal doesn't know what to do with them. So he has them sit outside in the hallway outside of his office. And they sat outside in that hallway outside of his office for hours. And finally, he was like, you know, enough's enough. And so he walks outside, and the girls are playing hopscotch on the tiles outside in the hallway. You remember the elementary schools had those different colored tiles, and they were jumping, bouncing back from each tile. And he took the three girls into a classroom. And when he got into the classroom, there were actually parents who were looking in the windows when they came in. And as soon as they came in, the parents came into the school, grabbed their kids, and took their kids out of school. So much so that by the end of the day, the only students left in that school were Gail, Tessie, and Leona. Now, Tessie had about enough. She was like, I'm not going to go through this. This is too much. Her dad lost her job. And so she left and returned to the all-black school. Gail and Leona went all the way through to high school, all white schools, all the way through to high school. Now, probably 2001, Gail and Leona heard that McDonough Elementary School was in disrepair and was going to be torn down. And so they decided that they would buy the school. And so they bought the school, rehabbed the school, had it placed on the United States National Historic Register of Places. And they rehabbed it, and they renamed it the TEP Center, the Tate, Etienne, and Prevost Center, which opened in 2022. It has affordable housing on one side. It has a restorative justice center on one side. And then on the right-hand side of that building, it's a desegregation museum, which is dedicated to the desegregations of the schools in New Orleans, Louisiana. So what a cool twist of fortune there. Girls who weren't allowed to go to the school, didn't want them at the school, have purchased the school and now made it into something positive, a museum. And I added because these are those three ladies today. And like Ruby Bridges, they are 68 years old. So our history is not that ancient. Oh, I forgot about, I added this slide. I wanted to add this slide just because it goes along with our premise that we're talking about. This is John Tyler. John Tyler was the 10th president of the United States. And John Tyler was president from 1841 to 1845. And John Tyler lived here. This was called Sherwood Plantation. It was a plantation that had 70 enslaved Africans on that plantation. But I wanted to show you this picture. On the left-hand side is John Tyler. On the right-hand side is Harrison Tyler. Harrison Tyler is John Tyler's grandson. Harrison Tyler's still alive. Still alive today, and that's his picture today. Just to show that our history is not that far removed. From a president from 1841 to 1845 who enslaved Africans to his grandson who lives today in 2023. Some of you may know what this is. This is the Juneteenth flag. June 19th, 1865 is the date that we celebrate the ending of slavery. June 19th is combined together, which gives us the term Juneteenth. But I wanted just to tell you the symbolic nature of that flag. So you see the flag. The flag is red, white, and blue for a reason. And it's red, white, and blue for a reason because it's letting everybody know that the 4 million Africans who were freed as a virtue of the Emancipation Proclamation were part of America, are now part of America. That's why it's red, white, and blue. If you look in the middle of that flag, there's one lone star. The reason why there's one lone star is because it was on June 19, 1865, that word made it all the way to Galveston, Texas. Galveston, Texas was the last city to recognize the Emancipation Proclamation, and on June 19th is that date. And so that's why you have the lone star in the center of the flag. And then you see this starburst coming out from that lone star, stating that that lone star, that message is now spread across the entire country. And unlike most flags, the horizon line on a flag is straight, right? But this one is bent, and it's bent because we are now encompassing 4 million more people, so we're becoming larger. So it's a larger horizon as a result of the fact that we're encompassing 4 million more people. Everybody knows this painting, or at least knows the person in this painting. This is George Washington. And when you see the painting, it's normally cropped, so you don't see the individual to the right of Washington. That individual to the right of George Washington is a man by the name of William Lee. William Lee was enslaved by George Washington, but he was with George Washington and appeared to be really close to George Washington because we have an opportunity to visit Mount Vernon and get to see a tour of Mount Vernon. You will see a lot of trinkets and paintings of William Lee at Mount Vernon. So you'll see in the top painting, there's a picture of George Washington and William Lee's with him putting the saddle on the horse. It's a picture of when painting of when George Washington was a land surveyor. There are different types of little statue there of William Lee that you'll also see on Mount Vernon. There's a bronze bust as you walk into Mount Vernon of William Lee. And in the bottom, you see a painting. It's George Washington and his family. And you can barely see it, but all the way on the right behind Martha Washington is William Lee. And then that last drawing you see there is the last drawing that was ever produced of William Lee. And all these things you could find at Mount Vernon. And so what historians say is that if William Lee was not, in fact, enslaved, because of his proximity to George Washington, fought with him in battle, land surveyed with him, all these things, that he would probably be considered one of our founding fathers, William Lee. You've probably seen this, George Washington crossing the Delaware. It was really interesting. I've seen this painting maybe a million times, but I never noticed this in the painting. So if you look at the painting, you see three individuals in the front. They're moving, pushing ice out of the way as they cross the Delaware. But if you look at the three, one of those three appears to be a black man. And I've never noticed that before when looking at this painting. And when you talk to people who talk about it, I kind of zoomed in for you. They say that that would be a representation of William Lee in that painting. We talked about George Washington. I wanted to show you George Washington. That's from the dollar bill. That's a painting of George Washington there. There's another picture, four pictures of George Washington. Why am I showing all these pictures of George Washington? I'm showing these pictures of George Washington because I want you to look at his mouth. If you notice, in everything I show you, his mouth always looks like it's clenched, right? And it's clenched that way for a reason, because George Washington had notoriously bad teeth. In fact, by the time that he was actually inaugurated, he only had one tooth in his mouth. That's a true story. One tooth in his mouth. And so George Washington had dentures. And the dentures of the time had a spring wire on a spring, an iron spring, that always had the dentures open wide. So when Washington put the dentures in his mouth, he had to clench his mouth shut tight to keep them from flying open. So you will never, that's true, that you will never ever see a picture of him smiling, one, and two, always with his mouth being clenched shut because he doesn't want them to fly open. If you've been to Mount Vernon, you'll have an opportunity to actually see those teeth. Those teeth are on display at Mount Vernon. And what's interesting about these teeth is that these teeth encompass a number of things. On the top row of the teeth are made up of horse teeth and ivory. And then the bottom teeth are made up from the teeth of his slaves. Interesting enough, Washington wasn't alone. Notoriously bad dental hygiene took place during that time. And so the market of teeth became a commodity. And you would see in the ledgers, and they even have the ledger at Mount Vernon, where you see the ledger where they're purchasing and selling teeth. And so they would, if an enslaved person would die, they would pull the teeth out of his mouth, his or her mouth, and sell them as commodities to make dentures for dentists. And what I love about Mount Vernon is Mount Vernon does not hide from their history. They tell it like it is. And I really appreciate that. Real quick, on the right, Thomas Jefferson. On the left, Sally Hemings. We know that Thomas Jefferson and Sally Hemings had six children. One of those children, the youngest, was a man by the name of Eston Hemings Jefferson. And Jefferson had 600 total enslaved people during his lifetime, and he only freed 10. And of those 10 that he freed, all of them were Hemings. And so Eston was one of the Hemings that was given his freedom. And Eston actually made his way all the way to Ohio. And he started in Ohio. He was a musician. He had odd jobs in Ohio. But we had a thing in America then called the Reverse Underground Railroad. Everybody knows about the Underground Railroad, which took enslaved Africans out of slave states and into freedom, free states, and even up to Canada in many respects. But the Reverse Underground Railroad were a group of people who would go around and they would kidnap free blacks and bring them back to the slave states. Probably the most famous you might be aware of is a man by the name of Solomon Northrop. Solomon Northrop told of his tale, wrote a book called 13 Years a Slave. And that was his story about being on the Reverse Underground Railroad. So that was going on in Ohio. So Eston wanted to leave Ohio because it wasn't safe. And Eston made his way all the way to Madison, Wisconsin. And when he got to Madison, Wisconsin, he had a son. His son's name was Beverly. And that's Beverly there all the way on the left with his three sons. They're all Jeffersons through Sally Hemings. But the interesting part about the story is that that whole family lived in Madison, Wisconsin. And in fact, Eston is buried at Forest Hill Cemetery in Madison, Wisconsin. Which is a kind of nice little fact. One of the Hemings, the oldest Hemings, was a man by the name of James Hemings. And James Hemings was actually the cook at the White House. The cook, he was actually Jefferson's cook. And Jefferson served as minister of France. And so he would travel to France a lot. And he would bring Hemings with him to cook. And while they were there for an extended period of time, Jefferson allowed Hemings to go to cooking school. And so Hemings became the first American, if you will, to learn at a French cooking school. And he studied there for a while. But in France, they didn't have slavery. Slavery was abolished. And so Jefferson had a choice. He either had to free Hemings or pay him a salary because slavery was abolished. So Jefferson chose to actually pay him. And what Hemings did with the money was he hired a private tutor, And the tutor helped him to learn French, and he wound up speaking French fluently. And he worked in many restaurants while he was there with Jefferson, many French restaurants. And when they came back to America, Jefferson would have these, they weren't quite state dinners, but would have a lot of people would come to the house. And he would always show off this one dish that Hemings made very well. It was a noodle dish with cheese, and he referred to it as macaroni pie. And of course, that recipe we now call macaroni and cheese. And so James Hemings has been credited with introducing French cuisine to America. And the three most famous are macaroni and cheese on the top right-hand corner, meringue, which are the white puffs you see there, and one of my favorites, French fries. So James Hemings was actually our founding foodie. Yes. So at 1865, slavery ends. Vast majority of blacks are in the South, rural South. And so it wasn't like today where you can just go to any store and shop for stuff. There were generally one general store. That general store was owned by generally a person who wasn't in favor of the fact that now all these blacks are free. And so we had these Jim Crow laws. And the Jim Crow word of the day was, if you are in a store and you are black, you have to wait till all the other customers who are white were served, and then they would serve you. So going to the store was a project, right? You just didn't walk in, buy something, and walk out. And so people would sit there and wait. They would get inferior products. They wouldn't get the best of what was being sold at the store. And it became this exercise of humiliation for blacks in the rural South. Well, all of that changed in 1894 with the emergence of this small company in Chicago called the Sears and Roebuck Company. And the Sears and Roebuck Company put out a catalog of 122 illustrated pages of things they sold. They sold everything. I'm sure everybody here is familiar with it. My kids are shocked that there was a book that had like everything in it. But everything from clothes and shoes to, more importantly, they sold guns, and it was the first time that blacks were able to purchase guns, and they didn't have to go through the general store. It was all shipped to your house. I mean, even, houses, fridges, ice boxes, all the things you can imagine, it was shipped there. And so it changed the game in Jim Crow South because blacks didn't have to rely on those store owners. That catalog is also credited with introducing to America a new form of music. So, the Sears and Roebuck catalog sold steel string guitars and harmonicas, which weren't readily available. And so, they became really popular in the Delta. And they would purchase all these steel string guitars and harmonicas, and they started a form of music, that music being called the Delta Mississippi Blues. So, if it wasn't for the Sears and Roebuck Company, we wouldn't have the destruction of Jim Crow and the introduction of Mississippi blues music in America, all thanks to the Sears Roebuck catalog. Ah, yes. So I have three pictures there. I'm going to go in order. So I'll start with the top picture. In the top picture, you may have seen this picture before. It's a pretty famous picture. There were three black teenagers who were accused of a crime. They were placed into the jail in Marion, Indiana. A crowd heard that they had committed this crime against a white family, and so or alleged crime against a white family. And so they stormed the jail, and they grabbed one of the individuals who committed the offense, beat him, took him to the front, and hung him in the tree in the front of the jail. They went back in, grabbed the other individual, beat him, took him, and hung him up in the tree. Now, there was a third individual. That third individual, they tied a noose around his neck. They dragged him from the jail to the tree. When they got to the tree and they were getting ready to hoist him up, so, and this is where no one knows. Some say it was a woman. Some say it was a superstar athlete from the University of Indiana who said something. But someone said, stop. Enough is enough. Stop. And they didn't hang that individual. But that picture you see was taken by a man by the name of Lawrence Beitler. And Beitler took that picture and it made its way all over Life magazine. And everybody saw the picture. And there was a young teacher in New York by the name of Abel Maripol. And Abel saw this picture. When he saw this picture, he sat down and started to put pen to paper, and he wrote a poem about this this sight in this picture that he saw. And he called that poem Strange Fruit. And then Billie Holiday became famous for singing that song, and she would sing it always last. And she would turn off all the lights in the bar where she was performing, the club she was performing, and then she would start singing the song. So I'm going to play a version just so you get an idea of what it was like. And I like to use the version of my favorite, Nina Simone, but I'm going to play just the first verse of that Strange Fruit song.
7 feet. Barren, strange fruit. Blood on the leaves. And blood at the roots. Black bodies swinging in the southern breeze. Strange fruit hanging from the poplar trees.
So you could hear that pain. You could actually paint the picture when you see that picture. She would sing that as the last song every night in the club. And the lights would be off. Well, turn this off. And the lights would be off in the club. And you couldn't see her, but you just heard her voice coming through the darkness. Powerful. Now, I mentioned on that date, there were three young teenage black men who were accused of the crime. The third is they put the rope around his neck and dragged him to the tree, but someone told him to free him, and he was let free. That third individual is pictured right there on the bottom right-hand corner, and his name is James Cameron. James Cameron. And James Cameron escaped and made his way all the way to Milwaukee, Wisconsin. And when he got to Milwaukee, Wisconsin, he decided that he wanted to tell his story and tell what he had experienced, and so he decided to open up a museum on 4th and North. And that museum is still there today, and it's the American Black Holocaust Museum. I just love that tie-in back to Wisconsin. Real quick, I'll just go through real fast. So you saw the picture of the lynching that I showed you, and you see all these people, and they're pointing, and they're looking at the camera, and they're posing for pictures. That was really common, and they used to make these postcards out of those pictures. They were called lynching postcards. And lynching postcards were sent through the mail. Like you would send a postcard like, hey, I'm in Vegas, right? They would be just sent all over the country. And they were eventually banned by the U.S. Postal Service. They wouldn't send them after 1910. And so what happened is those lynching postcards had this underground market. And they still get traded. I don't know if people go to Reddit, but there's still people on Reddit selling these types of postcards. But everybody would pose. They would take a picture. And I cut the picture because I didn't want to show the picture. But you can see the feet of the individual from the tree. Which brings me to this real quick. In Montgomery, Alabama, this is the National Lynching Museum. When you walk up to it, that's the first picture, and that's what you see. You see what it looks like as you walk up. But as you walk into the museum, you walk in the front door, there are 800 coffin-sized memorials. And they're at your eye level. But as you walk into the museum, you walk down. And as you walk down, it looks as if these memorials are growing up or rising up. And they're to symbolize someone being lynched in a tree. So by the time you're on the ground of the museum, you look up and you see 805 coffin-shaped memorials. Well, each one of those coffins represents a county in the United States. And it has a story of all the individuals who have been lynched in that county in the United States. And they also have a wall of jars, and the jars are where they wanted everybody to collect dirt from where a lynching took place, put it in a jar, send it to the museum, so they all have a representation of what happened on that ground on that day. And so there's only one jar that's actually full with dirt, and it's in Alabama, the site of this museum. But in Milwaukee, we had our own lynching. There was a man by the name of George Marshall Clark, who was lynched here on the corner of Water and Buffalo. So Shake Shack, where Shake Shack is located. He got into an argument. It was a mob. Two black men and a mob got into an argument. He was eventually lynched. He's the only known lynching that we have here in Wisconsin, the recorded lynching. And in fact, that's his grave marker. A young student from Milwaukee actually did a GoFundMe to get a grave marker because it's an unmarked grave. And that was the ceremony that was held last summer. And they took dirt samples from the location of where the lynching was being taken place. And our county exec, David Crowley, is actually going to transport that to Montgomery to be placed into that memorial. I'll end on this because I think I'm close to my time. So I'm going to end on this. And so the bottom right-hand corner is the Wisconsin Chair Company. And the Wisconsin Chair Company was located in Grafton, Wisconsin. And they were famous for making these cabinets for record players. And a lot of people made cabinets for record players at the time, so they weren't like setting the world on fire. But they decided there's a new form of music that was coming out, and it was blues music. And so they decided, what if we recorded blues artists here, made a record, and then put the records inside the cabinet, and that would sell those cabinets. And they did. And it was a big hit. And some really big blues artists, Ma Rainey, Blind Lemon, Sun Ra, even a young Louis Armstrong played on a couple of records. All done in Grafton, Wisconsin. And they started a record company called Paramount Records. And it was produced there in Grafton, Wisconsin. They would make these jazz albums. And but there was a strange twist to the story. And the twist was that Grafton at the time was a sundown town. So a sundown town means when the sun goes down, anybody who's black has to leave the town. So they would record these records, and as the sun started to go down, they all had to travel back to Milwaukee, which now is not a big deal, but was sort of a jaunt back then. And so the company was doing really well, but the artists were like, why are we going all the way up to Grafton? We could stay the night in Chicago, record. And so they started to record in Chicago and not come back up to Grafton. So as a result, Grafton, the Wisconsin Chair Company, lost a lot of money and eventually went broke. But the owners didn't tell the workers. They said, we're going to have this big Christmas party. And on Christmas Eve, they invited the whole factory to come in. They had food and drink, and everybody's having a great time, and they decided this was a good time to tell everybody that we are broke and you are fired, basically, right? And so needless to say, the drunken workers were upset, went in, took all the records, destroyed them, threw a bunch in the Milwaukee River, and completely gutted everything. Now, a couple of TV shows have went to that location, and they've sent divers in to try to find if they could find any of their records. They weren't able to find any of their records, but some of the most important recordings ever made in blues music were made right here in Grafton, Wisconsin. So much so that all the way on the left-hand side, you see that blues trail marker. Those blues trail markers are all over the South. So if you look, you say blues trail, and they show you the map, and you see all down South. Then you see one little marker in Grafton, Wisconsin, because Grafton, Wisconsin, that one's on Green Bay Avenue in Grafton, if you ever drive by it. But it tells the story of how Grafton, Wisconsin was once the epicenter of blues music in America. I'll end on that one. Oh, God, let's go. Woo-hoo. Perfect. I had no idea. All right, so I want to show you this picture. This picture is of Firehouse number 21 in Chicago. Now, everybody knows Chicago had a big fire, burned down most of the city, right? Old Miss O'Leary's Cow is the way I was in Chicago, and that was the song that we were told. But anyway, and so whenever there was a fire, firefighters took a lot of pride of getting to those fires quickly. And for some reason, Firehouse 21 always beat everybody to the fire. And no one knew why they always made it there first. And so the guy you see standing in between the two men seated, that's Captain David Kenyon. And he was the head of that firehouse. And he had this crazy idea. So the way firehouses worked is you had the wagons where they would pull and the horses on the bottom floor. And then on the second floor, they had the sleeping quarters. And then on the third floor, they kept the hay for, second floor, they had the hay. Third floor, they had the sleeping quarters for the firefighters. And they had regular steps. So horses aren't stupid. The horses would just walk up the steps and eat all the hay. So they said, this is not a good idea. So they built spiral staircases. And the spiral staircase would take the firefighters from the top level so they could get down to the bottom level, and the horses couldn't climb spiral staircases. So they thought it was a great idea, right? But it was incredibly slow, right? Because only one person at a time could go down the spiral staircase. So David, standing there, had this idea. I was like, what if we took a pole, and we put the pole on the in the bottom of the firehouse and run straight up, a wooden pole. They did. They lacquered the pole. And we slide down. So they did. And they made it to every fire before everybody else. And so the chief was like, what? I don't understand this. You weren't even closer than the other firehouses. How'd you get here faster than everybody else? And they said, we built this pole. And at first, everybody laughed and said, that's stupid. But sooner or later, people realized that you can get your firefighters there faster. So on that date, David Kenyon, African-American firefighter in Chicago, invented the fireman's pole. Oh, Gladys. All right. So I'm left with Gladys West. Gladys West worked for the Navy. And in the Navy, she was charged with this job of trying to figure out where all of our satellites were. They were up in the air flying around. So Gladys would be one of those hidden figures. There was a movie about hidden figures. Gladys wasn't one of them, but she should have been one of them. And so her job was to figure out where all the satellites were. So she came up with this algorithm that could pinpoint exactly where all the satellites were flying above the Earth. And she did this algorithm and found out, I know exactly where they were. But what she realized is when she could pinpoint where the satellites were, that the satellites could pinpoint where she was. And so she decided to, well, this is pretty good. We should want to know this. And on that date, Gladys West invented GPS. Gladys West is still alive. Gladys West is 90 years old. And Gladys West has never used GPS. That's the truth. She still prefers maps. That's the honest to God truth. You may have seen this picture before, and this is the exact picture that was in my history book growing up as a kid. You have Lewis Clark, and you have Sacagawea, however you wanted to pronounce it, however you were taught to pronounce it. And that is actually an actual painting, and that's the one you would saw in your history books if you were roughly my age, so 52. That would be what you would see. But that's the whole painting. The painting is actually this. That's the actual painting. And so if you look at this painting, to the left of Clark is a black man in that painting. And that black man's name is York. And York was part of that expedition. He was actually enslaved to William Clark. And he was part of the expedition that made its way from St. Louis all the way to the Pacific Ocean. And what's great about York is that York was actually part indigenous. And so he spoke many native languages. And so he helped them as they traveled on their way west. And we know this one story because Clark wrote it in his book that they were on their way to, they said they could smell the salt water. They could smell the water of the Pacific Ocean. But what they didn't know is they were crossing through Nez Perce land. And the Nez Perce weren't too keen of seeing this group of white men walk through their land. And so the story goes that the Nez Perce were going to kill them as they came through. And while they were getting ready to attack, up comes York. And York's coming up back because he's carrying everybody's equipment. And so he comes up, they see York. And the Nez Perce have this legend that there's a man, half crow. And that he will come. And when he comes, you must treat him with respect because he will protect the tribe. And so they had never seen a black person before that far west. And so when York pops up, they thought he was the crow man. And so they all approach, and they literally don't believe, they think it's a joke that they're trying to pull something over him. They take him to the river, and they start wiping him down to see if this black stuff will come off, and it won't come off. And they say he's the crow man. And so he gets them to escort them through Nez Perce land without being harmed. And they make their way all the way to the Pacific Ocean. Right? So they come back And Lewis and Clark become crazy famous, right? They write books and they're doing the speaking tours and everything. But York is still enslaved. And so he's not allowed to reap any riches from that. In fact, he's not even allowed to take part in all the things that they did. In fact, he got into an argument with Clark over it. And Clark got so upset that he actually sold him to a plantation owner in Kentucky. Actually, Louisville, to be correct. And Louisville actually created a statue. If you go to Louisville, that's the statue that they have there of York. And York, I didn't learn about York in history at all. I found out about him later. But since then, this is in Great Falls, Montana. You have Lewis and Clark there on the right, and York kneeled down with the dog. They're starting to honor York for all that he has done and his contributions to making it all the way to the Pacific Ocean. In fact, one day in 2020, right outside of Portland, there was a statue of a Seattle newspaper owner. But they found out in history that he was a misogynist, he was a racist, there's a whole bunch of things. So they actually tore his statue down. And one day, no one knows who, they put a bust of York and then on where that statue once stood. And it had a little plaque there of York. And we now know who that artist was. But at the time, nobody knew. And it was quite a mystery. But that statue was actually moved. And now it's in a museum. But now we're starting to give credence to York. Which, when I think about all the things I've learned about Black history or Blacks in history, I wish I would have known this more as a kid. Because I think in the grand scheme of who we are as a people, if we know more about what we've all contributed to this country, I think it would go a long way. This is Jean-Louis Baptiste du Sable. He was a Black fur trader, and he had a little cabin, and he was married to a Potawatomi woman, and they lived on the banks of the Chautauqua River. And this is actually their homestead right there. They had a blacksmith shop. They had baked goods, and so people were trying to cross. He would help them cross the Chautauqua River right there. And Du Sable became the first non-native settler in this location. And that little location right next to the Chautauqua River took the namesake of the river and became the city of Chicago. So Jean Point Du Sable is known as the founder of Chicago. In fact, that's his grave site right there. It's in actually Missouri because he actually made his way to Missouri. And the state of Illinois actually purchased a grave marker for Du Sable and had a place there in Missouri. All right. Cudjo Lewis is the male. Radoshi and Matilda are the females there. They were young kids, young meaning like 3 years old, when they were taken from Africa and brought here to America. They were brought here to America on a ship called the Clotilda. And the Clotilda was an illegal slave ship because they had actually banned the importation of Africans via the transatlantic slave trade well before this happened. This happened back in 1860. And so they were brought here to America. And in 1865, the Emancipation Proclamation happened and the slaves were freed. And these three, along with the others that were captives on that ship, wanted to go back to Africa but couldn't afford the money to do it, had enough money to buy 2-mile acre of land right outside of Mobile, Alabama, that the boat, the Clotilda, sailed into Mobile Bay, and they purchased that land. They called it Africa Town. It still exists to today's day. It's also on the National Registry. But the Clotilda, because it was an illegal ship, it was brought into Mobile Bay, and it was sunk, and they thought that was the end of it. But then they found it. In 2021, they found the ship in Mobile Bay. And the reason why I have them on here, because these are the three last survivors of the transatlantic slave trade. But to put this into perspective about how close our history is, when the last one of them died, who was Matilda McCrear, when she died, Betty White was 16 years old. Think about that. The last person on the transatlantic slave ship. Betty White was 16. Queen Elizabeth was 13. Jack Nicholson and Dustin Hoffman were 3.
3 years old. When you put that into perspective, to give you an idea of just how close our history is that we don't tell in our history books. Where am I on time?
Q&A.
All right. Any Q&A?
Of course I have a question.
I know you do. Christine, how are you?
I am fine. How are you?
Great. Great.
I'm glad, for anyone who might consider it, our trip to the Legacy Museum and to the memorial last year were life-changing, truly life-changing. So go there. Are you aware of any move afoot to mark the spot in the Third Ward where the lynching took place?
Yes. Actually, they are, there's a process to do that, and it's currently with the state right now to have a plaque placed at that location. So that is going on right now.
Your Honor.
Yes, sir.
We follow each other on LinkedIn, by the way. Dan Buttry, War
Memorial. Oh, Dan, yes.
So thank you for the history. I think that's absolutely important. I'm a former educator myself. We just published, as part of our education series, Company F, 29th Wisconsin.
Oh, yes.
And so it's now in our lesson plans online. We wanted to make sure it was live for this month for after Black History Month.
Can I tell you something real quick before you
get started? I wasn't going to pick on you, Your Honor, because never mess with a judge.
Real quick. So the house that I live in right now was built in 1853. It's owned by a man by the name of Charles Walton. Charles Walton led, was one of the guys who led Company F.
And that's in our lesson plan online. So
there you go. I live in his house.
I'm going to send you the link. Via LinkedIn, so you can share that, so we get this dispersed to folks. So,
yeah.
Thank you very much. Of course.
Please do.
Roger that.
Judge, you talked about you wish you had known some of this history.
Yeah.
Continue that a little bit and talk about what if our children knew more of this history? What would have happened? Just continue with that and let us know what do you think we would be in our psyche, in our attitude, etc.
Definitely. Thanks, Frank. So here's the story. This is a story. This is a true story that I'll never ever forget. I remember. So I grew up in Chicago, but I went to a Catholic grade school, high school, the works, and I was one of only a few Black students in the class. And I never forget. There's a kid who said to me, I think it was like fourth or fifth grade, he said, you know, what have Blacks ever contributed to America? And I thought about that for a while, and I thought about history books. I remember going in the history books and looking, and I couldn't find anything. I mean, there was a talk about Martin Luther King. That's about the extent of our Black history when I was growing up. And it resonated with me that not only the question that someone, that he had a question to me about, what did you contribute, but the fact that we didn't tell any of those stories. And so that's sort of what launched me onto this journey to do this. And there's so many stories that I wish we would have told because it gives us a better perspective of who we are. Here's what's so great about us, right? So unless you're an indigenous or First Nation or native population, your people either immigrated here or were brought here. That was it. There was no other way you got here, right? And so when they came here, they brought their clothes, their food, their culture, their music. And instead of us embracing all of that, because none of us were really from here, we decided that we wanted to build this melting pot. We wanted to melt all that away until we were all one homogeneous place. But just imagine if we incorporated all of that, native culture, Black culture, Germans, French, everybody just incorporated their culture here, what difference it would have made. The story in Black history or Blacks in history that moves me, one of the moves me the most, there's an African-American male who's in the Air Force. And John Kennedy wanted him to be part of the NASA program, the program that was going to the moon. And so they did the testing, and they're only going to take the top 11. And this gentleman came in eighth. And so he was going to be part of the NASA land on. Can you imagine a Black man and a white man planted the flag on the moon? What an effect that would have for this country, right? Kennedy gets assassinated. As soon as Kennedy gets assassinated, that push to have an African-American in the program isn't that important anymore, and he's dropped from the program. And so someone else goes and they make their trip to the moon. But just think about that one piece of history. That if you could see that, how that would have an effect on kids my age watching something like that. And then the kids, like the kid in my school, say, what have you contributed to U.S. history? So I'm asking you all to do what you can. You can follow me on LinkedIn, Instagram, Facebook. I do all these Black History posts, but also to push that we tell these stories, because people are trying to hide some of these stories, and it's important that we know the stories of this country. A lot of people don't know this, but blacks here have been enslaved longer than they've been free, and it's important that we know these stories. So, thank you so much for your time.